your law.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Amen. Remain standing for a word of prayer. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Father God, we just give you glory tonight, and we thank you for being the rock that we can go to in our time of need.
Yes.
And in our times of storms, we just appreciate you for how you've never failed us and how you're always there. Father, we thank you that no matter what we're going through, you're still there. Father, we just appreciate you now for this night. We thank you for those who are here, those who are on the way, those who are unable to be here. We ask you to touch and heal. We ask you to deliver right now
in the name of
Jesus. Father, we believe your word tonight. We thank you for your messenger on tonight. We ask you to strengthen him as he comes. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. You may be seated. We thank the Lord again for you being here on tonight. Thank God for another Wednesday night Bible study.
Amen.
It's exciting to open the word of God, to get an understanding. Amen. And so I'm glad about that. And so we're glad for our messenger on the night, and we're going to yield the floor to him. Say amen for him as he comes.
Amen. You've got to come back from Houston. Instead of unpacking new stuff, I ain't seen that. Oh, yeah. That's all right. I've got six or seven CDs from a lot of times. I know y'all don't need them because you watch the stuff on YouTube, but if you CDs, I have six or seven of those. Well, like, except folks like Mother Nod.
Amen.
How do you say it? Did you say amen again?
Amen.
Let's look at Job real quick, maybe. We've been doing lessons from the book of the prophet Jeremiah, a book in the Old Testament. A lot of times in the Old Testament, all I ever got was something out of Sunday school. They would like put a little snippet or whatever. But I never really got a good understanding of the book. We're down to, actually, Lady Deborah, you weren't here last Wednesday, so you need to do a little writing.
Okay.
So you're indispensable. Nobody couldn't take your place. That's really what
it is. No one could write it?
No.
Oh,
no no
okay.
one could write it because you weren't here.
Oh, wow.
So,
he didn't ask.
I knew you couldn't write it like that.
Seven.
Okay. I tell Vanna Jr. all the time, Brother Winston, if mama ain't happy, ain't nobody happy. Believe that. The seven, the one we had last week, the lesson was man cannot help himself. Man cannot help himself. The folks that's going to go to hell, they're going to hell because they were trying to help themselves.
Mm.
You know, people now talking about how hot it is. They're saying, well, it's hot outside. That's the reason that you need to try to live as good as you can so you won't go to hell. But you can't live good enough not to go to hell. The lesson tonight, number eight, is so, Bama, so you be
perfect. Okay.
Is God is a jealous God. That's what we're going to talk about tonight. God's right to be jealous. God has a right to be jealous. Because, Mother Nun, when something belongs to you,
that's right now.
You got a right to be jealous about
Amen.
It. That's yours. Now, you got no business being jealous about somebody else's stuff.
Right.
You see somebody else's car or somebody else's truck, or you want it or whatever, and you're jealous of them, you're wrong.
Mm-hmm.
You're wrong. But God is a jealous God. Look at Job, the 12th chapter. And let's look at the 7th verse. The 7th verse, Job 12 and 7. You see, I'm so pitiful, I don't really know why God has me doing the things that I do. This business is good. I don't know why he has me doing things to do. I just know he had me doing them. It's like, I don't really know why that we not pass out no juice and crackers, you know, but God showed me why. And the reason is because the juice and crackers was a part of the kingdom. And even Jesus told them, he said, I'm not going to do this no more until we come into the kingdom. But this is the age of grace. This was not prophesied. This was not talked about. The fact that God would save you exclusively on your believing that the blood that Jesus shed on Calvary's cross is full payment for your sins. Not from anything that you do. And for some reason, God does not want, I have my idea, God does not ever want us to mix law with grace. Law with grace. The law, everything was very physical. It was something that you could touch. It was carnal. They had the ordinances. They had different things that you had to do. But that wasn't it. It was just a symbol or a sign of what it was, a schoolmaster to bring them to Christ, because the law couldn't save them. But you know, you can get caught up in the symbols, and that's where the church is today. I guess they don't mean any harm or whatever, but Christ has become a stumbling block to the church. I was thinking today, Brother Carl Ray, that after God saved me, the church didn't lose any time messing me up. Because time God saved me, they told me, okay, we need to go baptize you. See, they added right there. They were saying, whatever God has done is not enough. Now, come on, let's do this right. And then they'll say, well, but now this is not saving you. Then why am I doing it? Why is this necessary? And the reason is because we did not study and we did not understand how to rightly divide the word of truth. Look what he says in Job 7. But ask now the beasts, and they shall teach you thee, and the fowls of the air, and they shall teach thee. Or speak to the earth, and it shall teach thee. See, Bro Jeff, it takes time. See, this right here, you don't just sit up, come to Bible study one time, two times, and get it. You have to study your Bible. You don't get it by listening to me. If you just listen to me on Wednesday and Sunday, and you're not going home and searching the scriptures to see if who God is, you have to get an understanding for yourself of who God is. And you only get it one way, and that is by studying your Bible. All right. Not by somebody telling you what to believe. But you can search the scripture so you can be convinced within your own heart. So Job says here that you should speak to the earth, and it shall teach you, and the fishes of sea shall declare unto thee, who knoweth not in all these that the hand of the Lord hath wrought thee, in whose hand is the soul of every living thing and the breath of all man. Doth not the ear try words, and the mouth taste his meat? With the ancient is wisdom. You see, you don't get old being no fool. You have to labor with this thing. And that is the reason that God put me on he said, leave them folks alone. You go on here, they ask you, you go and preach. Now I will go again if God tell me. But when I go preach other places, it's like I'm teaching Harvard to folks that's in the fourth grade. You still... you are yet carnal. Remember when Paul talked to the Corinthians? The Corinthians was all messed up. That whole book, through 15 chapters, it's a book of reproof, because they was all messed up because they were babies. They were children in understanding. It takes studying. It takes laboring to change the way you think. And the way you think is your life. It's not people. We want to put where we are on everybody, on what's happened to us, the fact that I'm black, the fact that I didn't have this. But the reason you have the life that you have is because of the way you think. That is the reason that Paul tells the Corinthians. He said, when I was a child, I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. And so there's a system of thinking that this word will change my thinking. And Job says, look at the animals. Look at the trees. They'll speak to you.
Yes.
You ever looked at Romans, the 6th chapter, where Paul talks about how that the old man has been destroyed? Mm-hmm. When you saved, your old man is destroyed. He ain't dying. The only way you can get saved is if you identify with the death, burial, and resurrection. And if you identify with the death, burial, and resurrection, when he died, you died. When he was buried, you were buried. When he was resurrected, you were resurrected with him. The word of God says it. He does not say the old man is dying. He said he's dead. Well, I know the question that's on the tip of your tongue. Pastor, if my old man is dead, why is it that I still not sin, but why is it I still want to sin? See, church folk trip me out about this stuff, but I made a mistake. It wasn't no mistake. I ain't made no mistake. Every sin I ever did, I wanted to do it. So, Lady Deborah, why is it that you saved, but you still want to sin? In the 6th chapter of Romans, that's when I tell you, beloved, that this is not an overnight job. And you see, I remember last winter, it's cold outside. We had 72 folks here. But you see, people can't stand the journey. You got to hang in there. If you want something other folk don't have, you got to be willing to do what they won't do. And if you want to get this... God has so done, Sister Word, Lord, where he has put his word where you can't just go to a page and get it. You got to compare scripture with scripture in order to get the truth. But when you get the truth for yourself, not from Pastor Blaine, not from Manasseh, but when you get the truth and you know the truth, Pastor Blaine said whatever you want to say. Manasseh can burn down, but you've got the truth for yourself. In Romans, the 6th chapter, the Bible talks about the body of sin. They are not the same. The body of sin is my enjoyment of sin and my remembrance of sin and my love for sin. See, the old man has been destroyed. He has not. It's just like he says, sin shall no more reign over you. It's like being in a castle. And it's a king in there. And they put a bridge, Lady Deborah, where you can sneak out the castle and go over to another castle. And now the castle you're in now it's another king there. And so now sin no longer reigns over you. You're free from sin. But what you have is the body of sin. And you have to, but you only know that through studying. Because now if you just come into church and you're singing songs, And everybody is talking about how rich they are and how God has blessed them, then you'll never have the victory. Look what he says here. Verse 12. He says, with the ancient is wisdom. Whatever question it is that I have, somebody has experience, and if I will humble myself, they can tell me. While I'm sitting there scratching my head, Barry, somebody right around me already know the answer.
All right.
And so the Bible says, with the ancient is wisdom.
Okay.
And in length of days, understanding. I am falling in love with an understanding.
Thank you.
I am falling in love with understanding. You see, you have to get in a place where God can teach you. You have to get in a place. God just talked to me. I'm telling you, he's talking to me these days more than I ever know him talk to me. He talked to me today, Brother Jeff, and he told me, he said, look, cut the conversations off. You're talking to folks. You ever talk to people, and it's like, this is just as crazy as it can be. It's crazy because it's supposed to be crazy. You talking one language, and they talking another language. Walk on off, forget about that mess. Make your head like flint. The Bible says how? Can't hear. Get the other mic. Okay. Hold on, y'all. What's wrong with this? It is?
Put it right here? Okay.
Let me see. Let me get back where I was. It's all right.
What was I talking about?
The Bible says.
I know I was talking about the Bible says.
Like slavery.
All right. Let's see. Let me just go to the scripture. It might come to me. It says, and in length of days, understanding. Look at verse 13. With him is wisdom and strength. He have counsel and understanding. You see, I can no longer afford to hang around lazy folks who won't study their Bible. You won't study your Bible and you want me to be all right with you. But you know, God put something inside your heart. You know, you, whatever it is you got, you had it before you ever got to Manasseh, before you ever saw Pastor Bland or whatever. Now, the Lord might bless me to refine what's already inside you. But as I said Sunday, I can't put it inside of you. God has to put that hunger and that thirst for his word. And if you got that hunger and thirst for his word, the Bible said you shall. He that hunger and thirst shall be filled. God will take you to a water trough. You didn't even know it was one around, but God will bring you to a place where you can be fed. So he says, with him is wisdom and strength. He have counsel and understanding. Behold, he breaketh down, and it cannot be built again. He shutteth up a man, and there can be no opening. Turn with me, if you will, to Jeremiah 2 and 13. So then, what we're seeking to do is simply to get an understanding. And if I want anything else from my study of the word, I'm going to be misled, because I found out that Satan is a master deceiver. Oh, we think we slick. We think we got game. But Satan is a master deceiver. And he's got good playing ground, because what he uses is self. And we love us some self. We fall out with folks when you offend self. We do. Cut our nose off despite our face. Jeremiah, what did I say? Jeremiah 2, 2 and 13. Jeremiah 2 and 13. You with me? Here the Bible says, for my people have committed two evils. You see, you are chosen by God. And when you're chosen by God, then God owns you, Mother Minnie. And so if you belong to God, God is going to be jealous over you. Jealous over you. Have you ever, when you was a little kid, Sister Trace Conner, have you ever told your mama about what the other children were doing? Mm-hmm. You ever do that?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Did you ever feel like that that your parents was a little too hard on you? That your parents, they wouldn't, you see? But the fact that you was their child, mm-hmm. The rules were different.
Amen.
And if you had a mama like I had, mm-hmm. She told you these words right here. I don't care what they do. And today, even today, I believe she meant it. She said that in such a way that even today she said, I don't care what they do, but what you gonna do. I be wanting to go so bad, but she gave me some good advice. She said, son, you ain't got no money. I said, well, they said they gonna take it. No, baby, you ain't got no money. So then God has a way for his people. And what all the book of Jeremiah is about, Brother King, is the fact that, come here, Brother Arthur, he took somebody that didn't nobody else want.
Uh-huh. Right.
He took Israel, and he took them, he took them when they was in their blood. He took them when they were but few in number, and he took them, and he married them, and he took them unto himself. And he took them for the best reason in the world, and that was that he loved them. You see, ain't nothing like being around somebody that loves you. Because you can mess up. You can get ugly. You can, you know, break verbs. You can, you know, do stuff that ain't all that pretty. But they ain't going nowhere because they love you. But what happened, stand up, Brother Jeff. What happened was God said, what I'm going to do, I'm going to give you what they have because they won't serve me. And because you belong to me. You see, you'll do more for yours than you'll do for other folk. You'll do more for yours than you do for other folk. See, ain't no limit when it comes to Vanna Jr. and Jeremy and Lady Deborah. It ain't no limit. I break my back trying to help them. So when you belong to God,
all right.
Nothing that he won't do for them. He took care of them. He took them through the wilderness. He led them with a cloud of fire by night and a pillar of fire, a cloud by day. He made sure that their clothes didn't get old. He made sure that the shoes, that he didn't let no diseases or anything come. He took care of them.
Yes.
He loved them. And he gave them the heathen's inheritance.
All right.
But when they got over there, instead of them being true to him, instead of them remembering all that he had done for them, they went and joined yourself with
him. All right.
Hold his hand. It's all right. We know y'all all right. If you ain't, it's too late now. We got it on tape. We're going to put it on tape. He joined himself with gods that they did not know. Now you got to think about, these the same folks who was in slavery. These the same folks that cried out to God. These the same folk that he brought across the Red Sea. These the same people that he fed every morning. That he made sure they was all right. But when they got into Canaan,
my Lord,
the Bible says they went a horn. Stand up here, Carl Ray. Stand up, Brother Dave. Not only they went a horn, go from one to the next. Come over here. Go to him. Wow, stand there. Then now go over there. Now leave him and go over there. Okay? They went a horn after other gods. And you see, you maybe can understand this. I know you're looking at it saying, well, this is just God. Don't nothing bother God, okay? But the problem is that God was married to Israel. Now, you that's been married or want to be married or whatever, do you want what you're married to be passed around to everything, to everybody? Is that they supposed to be your wife or your husband, but they going from... And the Bible calls it spiritual adultery. What the book of Jeremiah about is, it's about how that God is bewildered that you would leave me to going after God. And the thing about it is that these gods, they made them. The folks that's in the land that was carpenters and made brass, they made gods. And he said, you leaving me for somebody made. They got ears, can't hear. They got legs and they can't walk. Y'all can sit down. And what I can't understand is, as good, I'm getting some help tonight. As good as I've been to you all, I've shown. Ain't but about two or three folks know what I'm talking about. Look, let me tell you something. God was good to me before I got saved.
All right.
God was good. God looked over me. You know the Highway 49? Y'all got down there now. Y'all called Martin Luther King? I turned a little yellow Vega over about four times right out there and then went drunk and sat down on somebody's porch. Them folk could have killed me right there. The man didn't do nothing but come get me and take me home. God was good to me. I wasn't calling on God. I wasn't going to nobody's church. That's when I know grace is real. There is no such thing as do this and then God will love you. If you come to church, then God will be. If you pay your tithe, then God will be. No, baby. The God that I know has no stipulations on his love. The God that I know, he just loves me any kind of way. And I'm shaking off all this stuff you church folk done put on me. Do you know that folk can teach you stuff for so long that it's hard to get rid of it? Even when you see evidence. Even when you see evidence that this ain't even real, it's hard. Carter G. Woodson wrote about it in The Miseducation of the American Negro. Our people is a great example, y'all, of how miseducation can mess some folks up. Y'all, we ain't supposed to be as ignorant and crazy as we are. You see, our people don't respect nobody. They don't respect nobody. Look at you like they grown. Here I am. I'm old enough to be your granddaddy. And you look at me like I owe you something. Thank you, Jesus. They got good church folk going and buying 38s. I didn't want to do it. Thank you. Right. You ain't in the Bible, but you better get you one. He says, Jeremiah 2:13, for my people have committed two evils. They have forsaken me, the fountain of living waters, and hewed them out cisterns, broken cisterns, can hold no water. Mm-hmm. Now, Crystal, what you have to understand is that in this culture, wells and oasis, it was a desert down in the Sinai Desert. It was a very valuable thing to have water. Because you had to find somewhere for your crop, for your livestock and for yourself. And what he's saying is, I am the fountain of living water. Run over to John 7 real quick. Move a little quicker. You get it through your head that you're not going to get this overnight. There's a difference between reading your Bible and studying your Bible. And that's reading I say all the time. This is how it's going to be if there ain't nobody but me and you. Everybody not going to study, y'all. Most folk wants an easy, quick fix. That's the reason that the churches blew up. Who, they would have all the music, they would have all of the carnal things, and then they would have the oil up here, and then they would be, come up here, let me throw this oil on you, and say, this is the last day you're going to be broke. God finna anoint you. You getting ready to lay hands on people. They going to get up and walk. You getting ready to get a Mercedes. You get that, the church is full up. They took all the folk money. Ain't nobody get rich but the preacher. They still in the same shape. Because if it ain't based on God's word, it ain't based on nothing. I said John 7, run to 37. Then we're going to run over to Isaiah 55. We ain't slowing down one bit, y'all. I told y'all I got some gorilla in me. Thank you, Jesus. Mm-mm. Ain't scared one bit. Only thing I'm scared of is missing God. Mm-mm. John 7? John 7 and 37, I think. Ain't no 37? Okay, then. We can't find it then, can we? John 7. Okay. John 7. It is a John 7 and 37. John. The Gospel of St. John, Negroes. The Gospel of St. John, the 7th chapter. Y'all be thinking I was crazy. 7th chapter, I'm sorry. 37th verse, you with me? In the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood up and cried, saying, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. And he that believeth on me, as the scripture have said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. Go get 1 John for me. 1 John 2. First John 2. Got it? 27. Here the Bible says, but the anointing which you have received. You see, everything with the church is spiritual. And so it is his spirit that has been commissioned to conform us to the image of Christ. But Mother Davis, it's a long journey. And I can't get discouraged because I'm not where Sue is. I have to understand that God is leading me by his spirit, that the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. I'm going to fall and I'm going to stumble. And there's good reason, Lady Deborah, because in my falling and stumbling, God corrects me. You see, God has to prove me and he has to humble me in order that I don't try to steal God's glory. You see, God hates even a proud look. He hates even a proud look. The Bible says, the anointing which you have received of him abideth in you. The anointing. God's spirit, when you got saved, God's spirit was deposited in your life. Okay? Now, carnal things grieve. It grieves God's spirit. And that's the reason that I'm glad for Manasseh, because I'm in a place where man not getting in the way of what God wants to do. You see, and that's the reason that it's so essential that a leader, Crystal, learns how to listen. You see, because just for people to look at you, have you ever sat down and talked to somebody and you said, my God, I didn't know you had gone through that. I didn't know. You can't look at people and tell where they came from, what they dealing with. You see, and so that's the reason that it's so essential that a leader is led by the Spirit, because you can jump. You ever been hurt like that? Hurt in church where people just jump to a conclusion about what you was doing, or why you were doing it, or why you wasn't at church, or why you can't participate in this activity? He said, the anointing that you receive shall teach you. Teach you. But I have to be open to the Spirit of God. But if man's got an agenda, he don't have no time for you to be taught by the Spirit of the Lord. Look what he says here. And is truth. But as the same anointing teacheth you of all things, and is truth, and is no lie, and even as it have taught you, ye shall abide in him. Let's run back to Jeremiah. The greatest sin was idolatry, and it baffled, it hurt God. But the problem, look at Jeremiah 2 and 30. Jeremiah 2 and 30. This is a bad shape to be in right here, Brother Jeff. It's a bad shape to be in. And I always said, God, keep me teachable. God, keep me where I can say I was wrong. Keep me where I can say, Lord, you know what? I was teaching this right here, but I see now that this is wrong. Teach me not to be proud where I can't come back to the folks that I pastor and tell them, say, y'all know what? I was teaching y'all this right here, but the Lord has shown me that this was wrong. You see, because it ain't nothing but pride when you want folks to see you as right instead of wanting the truth. In order to get God and to get an understanding from God, you got to want God more than anything. You can't worry about your weakness, because he says that my strength is made perfect in your weakness. See, God don't help strong folk.
Take your time.
It's when you get broke down. It's when you have to give up. It's when you feel like, Lord, I'm about to have a nervous breakdown. God, ain't nothing I'm doing working right. I can't do this. I done all I know to try to make this thing work out. One reason that more women get saved easier than men is because women care more. You see, ain't nothing going to break you down if you don't care. But women care about their family. And so the Lord orchestrates and lets a threat come to your family. And when you feel your family threat. You'll call out to the Lord. You'll quit depending upon the flesh and depending upon yourself. Anybody ever been there? You say, God, help me. Help me, Lord. The folks that ought to help me won't help me. My own family look like they're glad that my family is going. My extended family look like they're glad that my family is going through this. David said, this poor man cried, and the Lord inclined his ear. What verse did I tell y'all? Jeremiah 2 and 30. Look what he says. This is a bad place to be, Brother Carl Ray. He says, in vain have I smitten your children. You won't take corrections. You won't. You're so stubborn. You're so stiff-necked. Give me Acts the 7th chapter. Acts the 7th chapter. This is what finally set Israel aside and ushered in the age of grace where we are now. Y'all, I'm just amazed that I didn't know none of this. I didn't. I guess I didn't care. You got Acts the 7th chapter? Here, here's Stephen. Come in for a minute, Carl. Hold that phone. Old man, got to fix my clothes up. Thank you. Here's Stephen. Thank you. Stephen is talking to the nation of Israel. And he has the same reasoning with them. As good as God been, you won't give him what is owed to him. What is God jealous about? See, you can only be jealous about what belonged to you. Well, we said in church, all the honor, all the praise, and all the glory belong to him. But when you go to church, don't it seem like they want the honor? They not only have pastor day, they have the usher day, they have the thousand red women in yellow stocking day. But you see, he says all the honor and the praise and worship belongs to him. And so he is a jealous God. He says that in Exodus, I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God. In one place he said, my name is jealous. So therefore, that what belonged to me, I don't expect for it just to be passed around. So now, look what he says. Let's start at verse 44. He said, our father had the tabernacle of witness in the wilderness as he had appointed, speaking unto Moses, that he should make it, that he should make it according to the fashion that he had seen, which also our fathers that came after brought in with Jesus, which would mean Joshua, into the possession of the Gentiles, whom God drave out before the face of our fathers unto the days of David, who found favor before God and desired to find a tabernacle for the God of Jacob, but Solomon built him a house. Look at verse 48. Howbeit the Most High dwelleth not in temples made with hand. So then this church is not the house of God, because the Most High does not. You are the temple of God. God save you. God's spirit resides in you. I don't care what you've done. I don't care what you did today. I don't care what you do when you leave here today. When God saves you and his spirit dwells in you, he don't leave. God's spirit. But now you can grieve his spirit. And you see, if you're like me, I never really understood how to walk upright. And it takes time. There's a long road to repentance. There's a long road to change. And what happened to Israel was an example to us. Look at what he says here. Heaven is my throne and earth is my footstool. What house will you build me, saith the Lord? What is the place of my rest? Have not my hands made all these things? Look at verse 51. The same thing that Jeremiah was saying. You're over in 586 B.C. Now you're over in 37 A.D. And you got the same thing. God has given people. Did God give you a long time? Has God given you a long time? He's long-suffering. God will give you room to be corrected. If you'll take correction. Do you know everybody won't take correction? You know the folks will get mad if you try to correct them? You have to learn. I've learned this right here, Mother Bland, is I try my best. Don't give advice unless you ask it. I don't have no advice. If you don't ask me for advice, and if you ask me for legal advice, if I don't have a receipt book, you're not getting it. Because I ain't going to ask you to pay my bills. I'm going to pay them. But I know how to pay them. And that's by working, not begging. You got enough begging preachers. Word. Amen. He said, you stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears. Now, let's don't pass over that now. Now, your heart is where God resides, in the heart of a man. That's where God brings you to a place of repentance or a place of a change of mind. And your ears. The Bible said they had ears to hear. They had ears, but they couldn't hear. So now he says that you are uncircumcised, stiff-necked in your heart and ears. You do always resist what? Resist the Holy Ghost. That's the reason we don't have any kind of appeals asking folks come to Jesus. Playing soft, these Osiris songs and having the choir singing in the background, swaying and all that. And you stand up there trying to persuade folks to come to Jesus. You can't get nobody to come to Jesus. The Bible don't say resisting the preacher. It said resisting the Holy Ghost. It is the Spirit of God. That's all right. Turn to 1 Corinthians 12. Well, let me finish this before that. He said, you do always resist the Holy Ghost. As your fathers did, so do you. Which of the prophets have not your fathers persecuted? Prophets of what? They were the ones that spoke for God, and they have slain them which showed before of the coming of the just one, of whom you have been now the betrayers and murderers. Turn to 1 Corinthians, please. 1 Corinthians 12. Thank you, Jesus. I'm so glad to know this thing is in God's hand and not in man's hand. You ain't got to be jumping through no hoops and turning no jumping jacks in order for folks to be all right. That would have made up my mind to be all right with myself. You can't please them. You're doing 1,000 times better than you were doing, and they still don't like you. You know you're doing 1,000 times better than you were. They still ain't got a good word about you. Not about your family. Y'all just as happy as y'all can be up in the house. Time you come out of the house, you hearing all this stupid stuff. All right. 1 Corinthians 12, did I say that? Look at what it says, 1 Corinthians 12 and 12. He says, for as the body is one and have many members, and all the members of that one body, being many, are one body, so also is Christ. For by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body. So the Spirit of God does the work. Turn to Jeremiah 9 and 1. We almost through. God don't want me serving no juice and crackers. He don't want me serving no water or nothing. He don't want me to depend on nothing but the blood that he shed on Calvary's cross. What a love. What a love. I even get scared when I see blood. You know when you get hurt or something like that, you all right. You say, you know, I'm bleeding. What? either you have been like this right here. You didn't know how you were hurt that bad. You know what? Somebody say, you bleed. You know it's serious then, don't you? The Bible says, because the life is in the blood. If you lose enough blood, you leaving here. You get ready to leave here. But the Bible says that he shed his blood. Knowing that he's going to give his life,
all right.
But he gave his life in order that we could have life.
Yeah.
And now I'm going to walk around here dead,
you,
and he died in order that I might have life.
You,
what did I say? Jeremiah what? 9? Okay, this should be the last one. It hurt Jeremiah because he was speaking for God, and he could see how jealous that God was. You know, when you see a man that's got a good wife, you see a man that's got a good wife, she's keeping the house, she's chaste, and you see him not appreciate her, just running around with nothing. Even though you're on the outside, you're shaking your head, ain't you? He said, that's a shame. Jeremiah is speaking to the nation of Israel, knowing how wonderful that God has been to them. Hurt that God got him speaking to a hard-headed folk that don't want to honor God as being God. Well, look what he says in Jeremiah 9 and 1. I'm going to let y'all go. He says, oh, that my head were water. And mine eyes a fountain of tears, that I might weep day and night for the slain of the daughter of my people. Do you hurt for these folk? Do you have a burden for even your relatives? How the folks are just blind to the truth and don't want to hear it. Because I know you've left here and got written down the scriptures and took them to them. And you thought for sure that if they should, Pastor done made it so clear that if I show it to them, they don't want to hear it. Sitting right here in the Bible. He said, oh, that I had in the wilderness a lodging place, a wayfaring men, that I might leave my people and go. See, Jeremiah is so torn. In one place, he wants to embrace them. In the next place, he says, I just wish if I could live. You've been through the same thing.
Amen.
In fact, I know you black mama went through that. Every black mama had the same script. I'm going to leave y'all and your daddy. I'm gone. I wasn't in your house, but I heard it. You know the beautiful thing about that? Never did leave. Never did leave. But they were speaking from hurt. Don't minimize that. They hurt. They was hurt. And that's the reason I'm telling you men. It makes no difference what we have been. We got an opportunity now to do better. They didn't leave us. We still got them. We got an opportunity now to treat them the way that they deserve to be treated. But you have to get an understanding. You have to get an understanding. And at the time, that was the best understanding you had. That if I go out and make some money, if I pay the bills, everything gonna be all right. He says, oh, that I had a place had in the wilderness a lodging place of wayfaring men, that I might leave my people and go from them, for they be all adulterers and assembly of treacherous men. Now, what he means right here is not sexual. He means that they are not spiritually chaste. They are going from this God to that God. They are committing spiritual adultery. Look what verse 3, last verse. And they bend their tongues like they're both for lies, but they are not valiant for the truth upon the earth. Manasseh, stand for the truth. Stand for it. It's not many. It's not many standing for the truth. But you stand. Because the Bible says that you shall know the truth. They promise you this, they promise you that, but you can do without it.
Amen.
Wait on the Lord. Whatever. And by the blessings of the Lord, bring no sorrow. And you'll be able to enjoy whatever you got. Because you know you didn't take down in order to get it. For the truth upon the earth, for they proceed from evil to evil, and they know not me, saith the Lord. Take ye heed every one of his neighbor, and trust ye not in any brother, for every brother will utter supplant, and every neighbor will walk with slanders, and they will deceive every one his neighbor, and will not speak the truth. Last verse over here, turn to 23. We did this last week, but we're doing it again. He said, thus saith the Lord, let not the wise man glory in his wisdom, neither let the mighty man glory in his might. I'm in verse 23. Let not the rich man glory in his riches. Verse 24. But let him that glorieth in this, that he understandeth and knoweth me. It take a long time, y'all, to understand God and to know him. You got to study. That I am the Lord, which exercise loving kindness, judgment, and righteousness in earth, and for in these things I delight, saith the Lord. Clap your hands for the Lord.
Amen. Amen. Sister Vivian, keep her in your prayers. Just several people on the prayer list, and I want to ask right now, is there anyone in the building that's soliciting prayer tonight? So Sister Andre's sister, Trina, we're going to keep her lifted up in prayer.
You know who that is?
I do. The one that ran me down to give probably one of the first offerings for this church. And so we're just thanking God even now for her, and certainly going to lift her up in prayer. Absolutely. Sister Madeline? Okay, and we are lifting Kendra up anyway, because Kendra has left to go to school. She will not, she won't be with us during the Sundays when we usually see her. So we want to keep her lifted up.
Amen.
Anyway.
Amen.
And now especially because of the fender bender. So thank you for that. Anybody else? Sister Teresa, Sheila's sister, want to keep her in prayer as well. Okay, if there's nothing else, Miss Minnie, do you have anything regarding Vacation Bible School? And Jeremy's here. Do you have his as well? Okay. Okay, absolutely. Okay, anything else? If there's nothing else.
Amen. 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 Am
y'all need to hear this right here. Y'all know Jeff right there? We call him Big Jeff. We call your husband Big Jeff. But I got folks stopping me on the street telling me, man, you're going to want to drive for Jeff.